سليم سيدي العبد صلوات
سلام के मरहूम के लिए और एक मोमना मरहुमा रुकैया भाई सुंदर जी और अपने मरहूम को जहन में रखते हुए एक दफ़ा सुबह हम दो तीन दफ़ा सुबह खास तौर पर मोहम्मद वाले मोहम्मद सलाम इसके साथ ही नहायत मुतमस हूँ हजरत इस्लाम क़िबला मोहम्मद नकवी साहब की खिदमत में आए और आज की मजलिस में मोहम्मद से खिताब फरमाएँ। सब मिल के नारे तकबीर, नारे तकबीर, नारे रिसालत, नारे रिसालत, सब मिल के नारे हैदरी, नारे हैदरी, हुसैनियत, हुसैनियत, यजीदियत, यजीदियत, बड़े खुशनुदी मोहम्मद वाले मोहम्मद आवाज़ बुलंद सल्लल्लाहु
for the fourth time. This time, A month or two shy of delivery, the man had to travel on a journey. He decided to tell his wife, prior to him going the journey, that if you delivered a baby girl, then you know what the family values are. You understand what we believe in. You know what should be done. Make arrangements for this daughter of ours to be buried alive. If it is a son, look after him for me until I return back. The woman takes the instructions from her husband. He leaves for his journey. The neighbor of this particular family is from a different tribe. They do not subscribe to this concept of burying their daughters alive. She befriends the neighbor. She goes to the house of the neighbor. She weeps and cries. They sympathize with her. She delivers a baby girl. After the completion of the period, she delivers the baby girl. Upon the delivery of the baby girl, she decides to go to the neighbor and tell the neighbor that I have brought this daughter of mine. Is it possible for you to look after this child for me? For I cannot do this for the fourth time. This time, it is possible for me to save my child. The neighbor agrees and looks after or takes responsibility of looking after this child and adopts this daughter. The man returns from his journey when this child has grown up a bit. As the child is growing up in the neighborhood, the man becomes fond of her without realizing that this is her daughter. He looks at this child, he becomes playful with her, he is extremely fond of her, he goes, visits her and plays with her. When his wife becomes confident that my husband has now some feeling towards this little child and has become fond of her, it is perhaps time for me to disclose to him that this is his own daughter, whom he is so fond of. So she slowly and gradually reveals to him that this child who he is so fond of is his own daughter. The man is shocked by the news. Slowly and gradually, without saying anything to his wife, one morning he wakes up and tells this child, let us go to the desert and play. They go in the middle of the desert. When a man starts digging a hole, he places himself inside the hole and tells this little child to cover the hole while he is inside. When the sand reaches here, the man says to him, now it is your turn and I will do the same to you. She goes inside and he starts throwing sand on this child. When the sand reaches here, this little girl screams and says, I do not wish to play this game anymore. It is enough. It is your turn now. But the man doesn't stop. He carries on and on and on and on until he buries his daughter alive. This is in the annals of history. When his daughter is buried alive, he is satisfied that he has been able to fulfill the tradition of his forefathers of killing their daughters alive. This is pre-Islam. This is the time just before the advent of Islam, when the man buries his daughter alive. Keep this in mind. By order of revelation, the Quran that we have before us is not how it was revealed. By order of revelation, the fourth surah that was revealed was Suratul Kubwirat, known as Takwir. Today when you open the Quran, it is Suratul Baqarah, and then it carries Fatiha and Baqarah, and then it carries on the small surahs until Wannas. But by order of revelation, that is not how this Quran was revealed. By order of revelation, the fourth surah that was revealed was Suratul Kubirat. In this particular surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُبِّرَتْ وَإِذَا النُّجُومُ كَدَرَتْ. When you go after a few lines, there is this particular statement regarding this concept where men used to bury their daughters alive. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. When it will be questioned about this little child that used to be buried alive, بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ, what was the crime for which she used to be killed? When was this particular surah revealed? Let me also give you a background before I can speak about what I wish to speak today. When was this surah revealed and what was the order, in the order, the fourth surah that was revealed was this, what was the occasion of the revelation of this particular surah? It was one evening, Ammar ibn Yasir had converted to become a Muslim. He was one of the youths who used to go and sit in the company of the Holy Prophet of Islam. He used to listen to what the Holy Prophet of Islam said. His father Yasir was still not a Muslim. His mother Sumayya had still not converted. It was only Ammar who used to go and sit in the company of the Holy Prophet of Islam and take pleasure in sitting with the Holy Prophet of Islam. Customary to his ways, he used to leave early in the morning and not return back until in the evening before sunset. And he used to be home from sunset until the following morning. One evening, Ammar ibn Yasir did not return back home. It was now past sunset and time moved on. Yasir and Sumayya are very worried about Ammar. They waited and waited and waited for him until it was late at night. He did not return. They worried for him and they worried what happened to Yasir or to Ammar. Nothing happened. They waited until early hours of the morning when Ammar returned back home. Upon his return, as a mother, she looks at Ammar, screams at him and tells him, my son, don't you realize that these old parents of yours would be worried about you. Where have you been? You have not told us anything. And Ammar said to his mother, mother, I was in the company of the Holy Prophet of Islam. And there was a surah that was being revealed unto him. And I was listening to this surah as it was being revealed to the Holy Prophet of Islam, or as he was narrating this revelation to us. And I was taking pleasure in it. It was at that point that Sumayya says to Ammar, my son, tell me what was so interesting that you forgot about your mother and father, that they were worried about you. And Ammar said, mother, this is what was being revealed. And then he reached this point where إِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to question what was the crime for which this child was being killed, he said, when he was reciting this and saying this to his mother, Sumayya stood up straight, looked right into the eyes of Ammar and said to him, my son Ammar, who is this man who is teaching you about the status of women? Had it not been for a mistake, my son, I would not have been your mother. Take me to him. It was at this point that Sumayya started having different feelings for the Holy Prophet of Islam. And this is what led to the conversion of Sumayya to become a Muslim, and gradually Yasir also becomes a Muslim in the head of the Holy Prophet of Islam. Saying this, keeping this in mind, this was the culture, this was the tradition. This is what the pagans used to do. This is how they lived. A woman had no value whatsoever. A man used to marry multiple women. When I say multiple women, it is not multiple in the Islamic context today. In the Islamic context today, multiple means four. But in the time before Islam, when I say multiple women, it was multiple not in terms of one, two, three, four, five, but it led to one man having control over more than 200 women. One man. over 200, and this is pre-Islam, it is in history, and you can read about it. 200 women, one man used to marry. When I say used to marry, how was this number increasing? The status of the woman, as understood by the people then, was that she probably was not even considered to be a full human being. It was at this time that a father used to marry multiple women. And then when he used to die, the father, other than the mother who had given birth to the eldest son, the rest of the wives were given to the eldest son in inheritance as wives, not as mothers. As wives, not as mothers. This is pre-Islam. With all that was happening around, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this in Quran. Allah in Surah An-Nahl says, وَإِذَا بُشِّرَ أَحَدُهُمْ بِالْأُنْثَى ظَلَّ وَجْهُهُ مُسْوَدًّا وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ. When a man used to hear of the glad tidings that a daughter was born to his wife. When man used to hear that his wife has delivered a baby girl. وَإِذَا بُشِّرَ, and بُشِّرَ in Arabic language means glad tidings, good news. So when a man used to be given good news and glad tidings that a daughter was born to him, Allah says, ظَلَّ وَجْهُهُ مُسْوَدًّا وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ. His face used to turn dark with anger. He had anger in him. He was enraged. He was angry that his wife had delivered a baby girl. Allah says, يَتَوَارَى مِنَ الْقَوْمِ مِنْ سُوءِ مَا بُشِّرَ بِهِ. He used to move around his members of his community, hiding away from them because his wife has delivered a baby girl. He was hiding away his face from the people of that time because his wife had delivered a baby girl. يَتَوَارَى مِنَ الْقَوْمِ مِنْ سُوءِ مَا بُشِّرَ بِهِ. Allah says, he then used to wonder, أَيُمْسِكُهُ عَلَى هُونٍ أَمْ يَدُسُهُ فِي التُرَابِ. He used to wonder, should he live with a humiliation that he had a daughter in his house? أَمْ يَدُسُهُ فِي التُرَابِ. Or should he bury his daughter alive? He used to have to make a choice and a decision. And he used to bury his daughter alive. Allah says, Ala sa'a ma yahkumun. What an evil judgment these people used to make. This is pre-Islam. Under these circumstances, when men were anxious, every time their women became pregnant, men were anxious. They did not want their wives to deliver female issues. They did not want baby girls. They were worried all the time. Whenever their wife was pregnant, and she was pregnant frequently, whenever she was pregnant, they were worried and anxious that she would deliver a baby girl. Under these circumstances, man was always praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a male issue. Man was always praying to his Lord for a male issue. But under all these circumstances, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in His wisdom, thought it best to give the Holy Prophet of Islam nothing but Fatima to Zahra, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. So what was the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He decided to give the Holy Prophet of Islam a daughter. He had a son called Ibrahim who did not survive. The Holy Prophet of Islam had many issues, but they did not survive. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His wisdom chose to give the Holy Prophet of Islam nothing but a daughter. You know, sometimes we hear about this lady of light, and shall I say, unfortunately, shall I say, it is probably our lack of awareness of the status of this lady that we always try to see her in relation to her parents, or in relation to her children, or in relation to her husband. Whenever we look at her, we say this is the daughter of the Holy Prophet of Islam. Or we would say that she is the wife of the man who unhinged Khaybar. Or we will say she is the mother of the youths of the chief of paradise. Perhaps it is our lack of awareness with respect to her status that we do this. There is no doubt that Janabi Fatima is the daughter of the Holy Prophet of Islam. There is no denial to the fact that her husband was Imam al-Muttaqeen. There is no doubt that her children were Sayyida Shababi Ahl al-Jannah. But looking at Fatima through them, you know, there is a scholar, an Iranian scholar, who has controversial views in certain areas. But he's a man, when you read him, you find him, he had deep insight into the status of Hazrat Zahra and the status of the A'imma alayhi salatu wasalam. His name is Dr. Ali Shariati. You may have read his book. He has written a fantastic book on Hajj and many other articles and books. He had some controversial views. That is not our subject. He discusses Bibi Fatima. He discusses her in his book. He has not named the book yet. He discusses one after the other the status of Zahra. He looks at her seerah. He looks at her life. He discusses her from every angle. He talks about her valor, her courage, her power, her strength, her eloquence, everything. Towards the end, he then tries to look at Fatima through Khadija bint Khuwaylid, through his mother. And he puts Khadija and Fatima together. And he tries to study them together. And he realizes, no, Fatima is beyond this. Then he leaves Khadija bint Khuwaylid and tries to bring Hassan and Hussein, her children, and places them together and studies Fatima with Hassan and Hussein. And he realizes, indeed they are Sayyida Shababi Ahli al-Jannah. Indeed they are Imams. Indeed they are her children. Indeed they have a status. And then he says, no, I cannot. There is something more about Fatima. And he moves on and places Amir al-Mu'mineen and tries to see Zahra together with Amir al-Mu'mineen, Imam al-Muttaqeen, Yasubuddin. He looks at all aspects. This is a man who was courageous, who was powerful. This is a man who said, Fustu wa Rabbi al-Ka'ba. He places them together and then he studies and then he realizes true Ali is Ali, true Fatima is Fatima. However, there is something more about this lady. He then places Fatima and sees her through the Holy Prophet of Islam, compares, studies, and then he says, no, I cannot say, or I cannot look at Fatima through Ali. I cannot look at Fatima through the Holy Prophet of Islam. I cannot see her through Khadija. I cannot see her through Hassan and Hussein. And then he names his book, Fatima is Fatima.
Muhammad wa ali Muhammad salwa.
Then he mentions the name of his book. He says, Fatima is? You know, a poet says, Maryam ka Fatima se bhala kya muqabila? A poet in Urdu says, Maryam ka Fatima se bhala kya muqabila? Maryam to abida hai, ibadat hai Fatima. He looks at Janabi Zahra. We look at Bibi through her father, through her husband, through her children. And that is how we glorify her. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is approached by Jibreel Amin in Hadith Kisa, Jibreel says to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Rabbi, وَمَنْ تَحْتَ الْكِسَارِ My Lord, can you please tell me who is under this cloak? The Holy Prophet of Islam is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being asked this question by Jibreel. Jibreel is one who is questioned. Allah is one who is responding. But in this hadith al-Qudsi, as they mention it, Allah doesn't mention the Prophet, regarding whom Allah says, لَوْلَاكَ لَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْأَفْلَاكِ. Had it not been for you, I would not have created this entire universe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Holy Prophet of Islam, it is for you that I have created this entire universe. Allah does not mention the name of Muhammad. He does not mention the name of Ali, his wali. He does not mention the name of Hassan and Hussein. When Allah is asked by Jibreel, Ya Rabbi wa man taht al-kisa, Allah mentions only one name and then gives relationship through her, making her the central figure. He responds by saying, Hum Fatimatu wa abuha wa ba'luha wa ba'luha. Relate her to them, or we may relate Fatima through the Holy Prophet of Islam, but Allah says it is Fatima. She is playing a central role in Hadith and Kisah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives nothing but a daughter to the Holy Prophet of Islam. Sometimes when you hear that in the middle of a sermon being delivered by the Holy Prophet of Islam in Masjid al-Nabawi, we hear this many a time, that in the middle of delivering the sermon, if Lady Fatima walked through the doors of Masjid al-Nabawi, the Holy Prophet of Islam used to pause the khutbah and the sermon and used to stand up in honor of Fatima. I use the word Fatima and I did not say in honor of his daughter. Because it is true, probably he was standing up in honor of his daughter. But one of the scholars says that there is no doubt many parents in the world would be extremely pleased to see their daughter walking in. It would gladden their heart. They would probably descend the pulpit and hug them. There is no doubt about it. And it has happened with the Holy Prophet of Islam. But he says, when the Holy Prophet of Islam used to stand for his daughter Fatima, it was not because he was standing for his daughter Fatima. It was because he was standing for his partner in his mission, his partner in the Nubuwwah, and his partner in the Risala of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She was his partner, she was not only his daughter. She was there given to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a purpose and a reason. It was at this point that the whole concept of seeing a woman inferior to man going to change through Hazrat Zahra salawatullahi wa salamu alayha. Allah willing, inshaAllah ta'ala, I will elaborate more about this inferiority of women against men, or the concept or the notion of inferiority of women against men, inshaAllah ta'ala, on Saturday. Today, I just want to concentrate on Sunday, inshallah. Today, I just want to concentrate on Janabe Zahra. And then I want to lead you into a very historical aspect regarding Hazrat Zahra, inshallah, before I end this lecture. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the Holy Prophet nothing but a daughter. Through this daughter, the Holy Prophet of Islam is going to change the notion of inferiority of women. He is going to grant a status to a creation that has never experienced equality with man, that has never been liberated, that has never been able to free itself from the eyes of man who saw her as an object of sex and nothing else. It was the Holy Prophet of Islam's daughter, Hazrat Fatima Zahra, salawatullahi wa salamu alayha. Change the mentality of the people for time to come, for posterity, an example that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes to give through Hazrat Zahra. When you look at her in the event of Mubahila, she is a central figure again in Mubahila. So in Hadith al-Kisa, she is a central figure. In Mubahila, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs the Holy Prophet of Islam that you, when you have to go and enter this malediction or the spiritual contest with the Christians of Najran, then say unto them, فَقُلْ تَعَالَوْ نَدْعُوا أَبْنَاءَنَا وَأَبْنَاءَكُمْ وَنِسَاءَنَا وَنِسَاءَكُمْ وَأَنفُسَنَا وَأَنفُسَكُمْ ثُمَّ نَبْتَهِلْ فَنَجْعَلْ لَعْنَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَاذِبِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs the Holy Prophet of Islam to tell them that if you want to enter this benediction or this spiritual contest, then you bring your man and we bring our man. تَعَالَوْ نَدْرُوا أَبْنَاءَنَا وَأَبْنَاءَكُمْ. You bring your children, sons, we bring our sons. وَنِسَاءَنَا وَنِسَاءَكُمْ. You bring your women, we bring our women. وَأَنفُسَنَا وَأَنفُسَكُمْ. ثُمَّ نَبْتَهِلْ. Then we will enter the spiritual contest. فَنَجْعَلْ لَعْنَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَاذِبِينَ. And we will invoke curses upon the liars. The term used is plural by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is expected for him to take women and not a woman. This is the instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet the Holy Prophet of Islam understands the maslaha of this revelation and decides to take no one but Hazrat Zahra, and takes her in a particular manner, showing the world that the central figure that links nubuwwah to imamah and ultimately to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is none but Fatima to Zahra salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. There are verses of Quran that are specifically related to her. Surah Al-Dahar, in which there is this spirit of sacrifice that is being glorified by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with regard to Hazrat Zahra. He talks about the spirit of sacrifice when for 3 consecutive days of her fasting she is visited by guests and she has to give up her iftar and her children's iftar for the sake of these people who have walked into her house knocking. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala recognizes this. Not only does he recognize it, he glorifies and he talks and acknowledges the contributions of Hazrat Zahra by saying that there are some people on this planet, on this earth, who feed وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَى حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا وَأَسِيرًا. There are some people who feed the miskeen, the yatim, the asir, the captive, the orphans, and the destitute. And not only do they do that, they say unto them, إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ. We have fed you for the sake of Allah. لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا. We want no recompense or anything else from you or any gratitude from you. All we want, all we have done is fed you in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is here again that you see the status of Fatima al-Zahra being spoken by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, she is a waliyatullah on earth. She is the waliyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth, in her own right, by her own merit, independent of her relationship with her father, her sons, or her children, or anyone else, or her husband. She is the waliyah and the hujjah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth. Keeping this in mind, I have to move to Urdu. But just one more statement here, and then inshallah ta'ala I will move to Urdu. The ayah of Tathir is the ayah which guarantees the purification of the holy household by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he says, إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلِ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَهِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. This thorough purification, this purification that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about needs to be understood. Surely this purification is more than just blood and filth or najasat that we understand. Surely this purification has a much, much more deeper meaning than the superficial meaning that we understand. Spirituality is what is the maqsood or the purpose or the intention of this particular verse. where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about the purification of the holy household. Again, in this whole concept of purification, the central figure is Hazrat Zahra again. But Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, during the time of the second caliph, there is a book known as Al-Ihtijaj, written by Allama Tabrizi. It's one of the very important books. In this particular book, it is mentioned that the second caliph, Umar ibn al-Khattab, was one of the most just individuals. In his hukuma, in Sahih Bukhari, it is mentioned that he was one of the just people. So, Allama Tabrizi in Al-Ihtijaj mentions something with regard to the purity of Hazrat Zahra. And he says, once Amir al-Mu'mineen was sitting together with Umar ibn al-Khattab, and they were having some sort of a discussion. During this discussion, Amir al-Mu'mineen placed a hypothetical question to Umar ibn al-Khattab and said to him that I want to place before you or ask you a hypothetical question. And they discussed the question and he said, ask me. He says, you are the caliph of the time, you are the judge and the ruler. I am putting a hypothetical question before you. If Fatima, the daughter of the Holy Prophet of Islam, is brought before you, accused of something indecent, na'udhu billah, a crime that she has committed, and that she is brought before your court, accused of something indecent, what would be your judgment against the daughter of the Prophet? Allama Tabrizi says that Umar ibn al-Khattab responded and he said, the scales of justice are blind. Right is right. Wrong is wrong. It doesn't matter who it is. Whoever is brought, and if it is proven that they are people who have committed a crime or they are innocent, they will be dealt with accordingly. It matters not who is brought there. So he says, so what would be your judgment against the daughter of the Prophet? He said, if there are witnesses that will prove and give evidence against her, and I am satisfied with the witnesses of these people, I will judge accordingly. That means I will see her as someone who has committed a crime, and I will judge her accordingly. At that point, Amir al-Mu'mineen, according to Allama Tabrizi, says, in that case, you will become a kafir. And that was not an ordinary statement for Amir al-Mu'mineen to say to someone who was the leader of the hukuma at that particular time. He says, in that case, you will become a kafir. He said, why will I become a kafir? Amir al-Mu'mineen says, I placed a hypothetical question before you for you to realize the status of this particular lady. And you have judged that she will be dealt with accordingly. I am telling you, you will become a kafir. He says, why? He says, because someone like Allah has given witness to her purity, irrespective of who comes and speaks anything against her. It cannot be anything but what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. In terms of the taharat of Fatima to Zahra salawatullahi wa salamu alayha, promised to remove every abomination. Azizan Igrami, naamon mein se, janaab Sayyida ke naamon mein se ek naam hai Siddiqa. Subhanallah. Bas isi pe main inshaAllah apni taqreer ko, aapki zahmaton ko inshaAllah tamam kar. Naamon mein se janaab Sayyida ke ek naam hai Siddiqa. Sadiq, yani sach bolne wala, sadiqa yani sach bolne wali, siddiqa angrezi mein zaman se sach bolne wali, Ya wala nahi, Siddiq. Every fiber of the existence is nothing but manifestation of the truth. Usko kehte hai Siddiqa. Yani jism ka rom rom, such or truth ka manifestation. Janabi Sayyida ka naam hai Siddiqa. Is naam ko aap zehen mein rakhiye. Ibn Abi al-Hadid al-Mu'tazali ka naam suna hoga aapne, agar nahi suna to Ahle Sunnat wal Jamaat ke bahut bade ulama mein se ek alim guzre hain jinhone Sharh Nahjul Balagha likhi, famous puri duniya. Uska naam hai Sharh Nahjul Balagha. Is Sharh Nahjul Balagha ke andar Ibn Abi al-Hadid al-Mu'tazali likhte hain ki maine janab Sayyida ke tamam alqab ko dekha, study kiya. میں نے فدق کو سٹڈی کیا, میں نے تمام چیزوں کو سٹڈی کیا, میں نے خصوصاً اس نام کے اوپر ریسرچ کیا جو نام ہے صدیقہ. اس کے بعد میری ذہن میں یہ بات نہیں آئی کہ اگر کسی کا نام صدیقہ ہو اور جس کے نام کو صدیقہ, پوری کائنات جس کو صدیقہ کہے, جو سچ بولنے والی ہو, جس کے سچ میں کوئی شک نہ ہو, جس کی سچائی میں کوئی شک نہ ہو, اس کو کیسے جھٹلایا ہے؟ پوچھتے ہیں اس عورت کو, اس بیوی کو کیسے جھٹلایا گیا. تو کہا میں اس کشمکش میں تھا, میں سوچ رہا تھا کہ کیسے اس بیوی کو جھٹلایا گیا. تو کہا میں سوچتے سوچتے میں اپنے استاد کے پاس آیا, میں نے اپنے استاد سے گفتگو کی, میں نے اپنے استاد سے بات کی. میرے استاد کا نام ہے ابن الافارقی. میں نے ابن الافارقی سے سوال پوچھا. اب سنیے گا اس سوال کو اور عربی زبان میں اور لطف آئے گا. میں نے اپنے استاد سے یہ سوال پوچھا اور میں نے کہا اکانت فاطمہ صادقہ. میں نے اپنے استاد سے یہ سوال پوچھا, کیا فاطمہ صادقہ تھی, یعنی سچ بولتی تھی؟ تو کہا میرے استاد نے جواب دیا بل صدیقہ. صادقہ نہیں تھی, صدیقہ تھی. ہاں صادقہ نہیں تھی, صدیقہ تھی. کہا اگر صدیقہ تھی اور یہ بات ثابت تھی تو کیوں جب دربار میں رسول کی بیٹی پہنچی ہے, کیوں دربار کے اندر اس صدیقہ کو صدیقہ مانا نہیں گیا؟ ذرا اس بات کو سنیے گا اور اس کے بعد انشاءاللہ میں آپ کی زحمتوں کو تمام کروں گا. فرماتے ہیں کہ میں نے اپنے استاد سے پوچھا کہ اگر صدیقہ تھی اور لوگوں کے سامنے یہ ثابت تھا کہ یہ صدیقہ ہے, تو بیوی دربار میں آئی اور لوگوں کے سامنے بیوی نے فدق کو کلیم کیا, کیسے لوگوں نے ان کو صدیقہ نہیں سمجھا اور کیوں حاکم وقت نے جناب زہرا کو فدق نہیں دیا؟ تو کہتے ہیں میرے استاد فتبسما, میرے استاد مسکرائے اور مسکرا کے کہا لو اعطاها فدقا اليوم مجردا بدعواها. سنیے گا, کہا میرے استاد نے کہا کہ اگر جناب سیدہ کو اپنے دعوے کے اوپر کہ یہ فدق میرا ہے اور میرے بابا نے مجھے دیا ہے, اس دعوے کے اوپر محض جناب سیدہ کو فدق دیا جاتا تو یہ بات ثابت ہو جاتی کہ یہ صدیقہ ہے, یعنی پورے دربار میں یہ اعلان ہو جاتا کہ اس میں شک نہیں ہے کہ یہ صدیقہ ہے. جب یہ ہو جاتا لجاءت غدا ودعت لزوجها الخلافة, تو یہ کل پھر آتی اور اپنے شوہر کے لیے خلافت کا مطالبہ کرتی. یہ کل پھر آتی کیونکہ پہلے دن یہ ثابت ہو جاتا کہ یہ رسول کی بیٹی ہے, یہ صادق کی بیٹی ہے, یہ صدیقہ ہے خود, اس میں شک نہیں کہ یہ سچ بولتی ہے, یہ ثابت ہو جاتا تو دوسرے دن امپوسیبل تھا کہ اس کے کلیم کا انکار کیا جا سکتا, اسی لیے پہلے دن سے اس کلیم کو سپریس کر دیا. میرے عزیز دوستو, میں تو یہ سمجھتا ہوں, علماء کرام موجود ہیں, میں تو یہ سمجھتا ہوں کہ جناب زہرا کا دربار میں آنا اور دربار میں لوگوں کے سامنے پیش ہونا, میں سمجھتا ہوں کہ یہ خود حکومت وقت اور حاکم وقت نے اپنے لیے ایک ٹریپ بنایا اب کو اپنے آپ کو پھنسانے کے لیے. ورنہ جس کا باپ یہ کہتا ہو کہ دنیا کے پیچھے نہ بھاگو, جس کا باپ یہ کہتا ہو کہ یہ دنیا فانی ہے, جس کا باپ یہ کہتا ہو کہ اس دنیا کو چھوڑ دو, جس کے شوہر نے کہا غری غیری قد طلقت کی سلاف, میں 3 مرتبہ تمہیں طلاق دے چکا, جس کے بابا نے اس دنیا کو چھوڑ دیا, جس کے شوہر نے کہا یہ دنیا کو میں طلاق دے چکا, وہ بھی فلک کے لیے اتنا گریہ کرتی, فلک کے لیے اتنا گریہ کرتی, کبھی سوچا ہے میں نے؟ وہ جس کے باپ نے کہا کہ یہ دنیا کوئی شے نہیں, جس کے شوہر نے کہا میں 3 مرتبہ طلاق دے چکا ہوں, وہ ایک فلک کے لیے, ایک اویسس کے لیے جہاں کھجور کی درختیں تھیں, اس کے لیے اتنا گریہ کرتی کہ دربار میں آنا پڑتا؟ نہیں میرے عزیز دوستو, اس لیے زہرا دربار میں نہیں آئی, زہرا اس لیے دربار میں آئی تاکہ دنیا کو بتا دے کہ جس مسند پہ تم بیٹھے ہو یہ مسند تمہاری نہیں ہے, یہ جگہ تمہاری نہیں ہے, اور یہی ایک موقع تھا. ورنہ 18 سال سے پہلے جب تک رسول تھے, she was overshadowed by the holy prophet, کچھ نہیں کہہ سکتی تھی, جب تک مولا کائنات تھے خاموش تھی, کچھ کہتی نہیں تھی, لیکن رسول کی وفات کے بعد جناب سیدہ کے علوم کے بارے میں دنیا کو پتا چلا کہ جناب سیدہ کیسی عالمہ ہے اور کیسے علوم جانتی ہے. کب؟ جب جناب سیدہ اس دربار میں آئی اور اس دربار میں یہ دعویٰ کیا کہ یہ فلک میرا ہے, تاکہ یہ بتا سکے دنیا کو کہ علی ابن ابی طالب خلیفہ ہے اور یہ مسند جس پہ تم بیٹھے ہو یہ مسند تمہاری نہیں. میرے عزیز دوستو, ورنہ جناب زہرا ایک فلک کے لیے اتنا گریہ کرے, یہ میرے ذہن میں بات. چھٹے امام امام جعفر صادق صلوات اللہ وسلام علیہ, زمانے کی ایک بات ہے, مگر یہ بی بی کبھی کبھی آپ یہ سوچا کریں جناب سیدہ کے بارے میں, جب مصائب سنیں تو آپ یہ سوچا کریں کہ جناب سیدہ نے یہ کیوں کہا, یا تو 75 دن کی روایت ہے اور یا تو 90 دن کی روایت ہے, یا 90 دن کے بعد جناب سیدہ اس دنیا سے پوچھ کر چلی گئی, یا 75 دن کے بعد, اس سے زیادہ نہیں ہے. ان دنوں میں جناب سیدہ کا مشغلہ یہ رہا کہ گھر سے باہر جاتی تھی, بابا کی قبر پہ بیٹھتی تھی, قبر کے اوپر ہاتھ رکھتی تھی, گریا کر کے کہتی تھی بابا صبت علی مصائب لو انہا صبت علی ایام سرنا لیالیا, بابا آپ کے بعد فاطمہ پر ایسی مصیبتیں پڑی ہیں کہ اگر یہ مصیبتیں دن پہ پڑتی تو دن رات پہ تبدیل ہو جاتی. کبھی یہ سوچا کیجئے کہ 75 دن میں, 75 دن میں تو کوچ کر چلی گئی, یا 90 دن کے اندر جناب زہرا اس دنیا سے وفات پا کر چلی گئی, مگر اس کے درمیان کیا ہوا کہ جناب زہرا نے کہا بابا صبت علی مصائب لو انہا صبت علی الایام سرنا لیالیا. ایک جواب خود دیتی ہیں, اپنے بابا کی قبر پہ بیٹھ کے کہتی ہیں بابا لست ابکی لما یصنع بی, بابا میں اس لیے نہیں روتی کہ مجھ پر مظالم ڈھائے گئے. جناب سیدہ کہتی ہیں بابا میں اس لیے گریہ نہیں کرتی کہ مجھ پر مظالم ڈھائے گئے, لست ابکی لما یصنع بی ولكن ابکی لفراقك یا رسول اللہ, بابا آپ کی جدائی فاطمہ سے برداشت نہیں ہوتی. یہ کہا کرتی تھی بابا کی قبر پہ بیٹھ کے. راوی کہتا ہے بی بی گھر سے باہر نکلتی تھی, گریا کرتی تھی گھر کے اندر, تو گھر والے کہتے تھے کہ یا علی سیدہ سے کہہ دیجئے یا دن میں رویا کرے یا رات میں رویا کرے, مولا کائنات نے بیت الحزن بنایا, جناب سیدہ جایا کرتی تھی بیت الحزن. راوی کہتا ہے میں دیکھتا تھا کبھی کبھی عجیب و غریب مصائب,
कभी-कभी रावी अजीब बात लिखता है, कहता है मैं देखता था कि रसूल के घर से एक बीवी निकलती थी जिसकी कमर झुकी हुई होती थी, घर से बीवी निकलती थी जिसकी कमर झुकी हुई होती थी, साथ में हसन और हुसैन के साथ जाया करती थी और बाबा से कहा करती थी बाबा सुब बता ले या मसाइब लो अल्लाह सुब बता ले या मिसर न ले आ दिया। न जाने जनाब ज़ैनब की पसलियों की क्या हालत थी, कमर झुकने की क्या वजह थी, मगर छठे इमाम के जमाने में एक मर्तबा कहते हैं बनू अब्बास का जमाना था, छठे इमाम का जमाना था, उस जमाने के अंदर कहते हैं एक बीवी है, इस मसाइब को सुनिएगा आपका दिल तड़प जाएगा। जब पहली मर्तबा मैंने इस मसाइब को पढ़ा, मैं खुद देख के इस मसाइब को ज़ारो क़तार रोने लगा। छठे इमाम का जमाना था, छठे इमाम के जमाने में कहते हैं बनू अब्बास का जमाना था, जमाना हॉस्टाइल था, अहले बैत का नाम लेना भी मुश्किल था और दुश्मनान अहले बैत को आप कुछ कह नहीं सकते थे। बाजार में एक बीवी थी, एक औरत थी जो चलते चलते बाजार के बीच में गिर गई। जब ये बीवी गिरी है, जब ये औरत गिरी है, तो गिरते गिरते इस औरत के मुंह से दुश्मनान अहले बैत के लिए लानत निकली। सिपाह खड़े हुए थे बनू अब्बास के, और जब इस बीवी से दुश्मनान अहले बैत की लानत को सुना है तो इस औरत को गिरफ्तार किया, गिरफ्तार करके इसको कैद खाने में ले गए। एक सहाबी इमाम खड़ा देख रहा था, गिरिया करने लगा, गिरिया करके छठे इमाम के घर पे आए, छठे इमाम के घर पे पहुंचा और कहा इब्ने रसूलुल्लाह, तकुल बात किया, मौला ने दरवाजा खोला, कहा इब्ने रसूलुल्लाह मैं आपसे मिलने आया हूँ। मौला ने घर के अंदर बुलाया, कुछ खजूर रखे मेहमान नवाजी के लिए कि कुछ खजूर खाओ। मेहमान जो सहाबी था उसने खजूर खाने से इनकार किया, ज़ारो क़तार गिरिया करता रहा। तो पूछा छठे इमाम ने गिरिया करने का सबब क्या है, फरमाया अपना रसूलुल्लाह बाजार में चल रहा था, बाजार में जा रहा था, एक औरत गिर गई, उसके मुंह से दुश्मनान अहले बैत के लिए लानत निकली, सिपाह ने गिरफ्तार किया, इस औरत को कैद खाने में डाल दिया है, ये अपना रसूलुल्लाह इसके लिए दुआ कीजिए। मौला ने फरमाया जाओ, रिहा हो गई और उसको तुम लेकर आओ, मैंने दुआ कर ली। जाके सहाबी उस औरत को लेकर आते हैं, ये औरत छठे इमाम के सामने आती है और छठे इमाम पूछते हैं बीबी तुम्हारे रोने का क्या मकसद था, तुमने क्यों ये हरकत की, तुम जानती हो कि अहले बैत के दुश्मनों का नाम अहले बैत का नाम लेना भी नागवार है, तुम जानती हो कि दुश्मनान अहले बैत मौजूद है दुनिया में, तुमने ये हरकत क्यों की। तो बीबी कहती है, वो औरत कहती है अपना रसूलुल्लाह मैं आपको क्या बताऊं, जब मैं गिरी हूं तो पसलियों के ऊपर गिरी है। मैं आपको क्या बताऊं अपना रसूलुल्लाह, जब मैं गिरी हूं तो पसलियों पे गिरी, बेसाख्ता मेरी जबान पे दुश्मनान अहले बैत का नाम आया इसलिए कि ज़हरा याद आ गई। मौला ने सर से अमामे को उतारा,
पहलू भी शिकस्ता है,
शिकस्ता है Yeah.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala